Good morning. How y'all doing today? Good morning. Y'all hear me? Can you hear me? Can you hear me back there, Dwayne? Hallelujah. Y'all hear me okay? I'm so glad y'all are here today. Praise the Lord. It's a great day to be in the house of God. As we're started today, I want you to look in your bulletin just a minute here. Look in your bulletin. And I want you to look on the bottom right-hand side. There's a little thing in there that deals with the Mount Pleasant cookbook. So every church I've ever been at, we always did these little fundraisers with the cookbook. But they're trying to do something. See, Jessica, was you going to speak on that?
I can.
Get up there and sell me something. Right.
Anyway, we're going to do a cookbook for this year as a fundraiser for our children or our youth. So we're looking for three to five recipes. We're going to have them all due by the end of this month, and we're going to try and have them all finished and back to us by Mother's Day or around Mother's Day, so we can use those. And those would be a great present, hint, hint, for Mother's Day.
So let me ask you this, Jessica. Would you be able to put like pictures of little small pictures in there too?
Or Leslie, didn't we talk about that? Yeah. She said there's a way that we can add a little photograph.
So think, so some of your ancestors and stuff, you know, that would have different recipes, if you're willing to share them, you can take your picture, you can put your picture on there and put it with their recipe. So at some of the churches I've pastored before, like in Effie, Louisiana, I still have it with my oldest son. I still got pictures. Him a little bitty, he'd have little things that he would make and stuff, and it's in there. It just makes a really good memory. It's also a fundraiser. Miss Sue and them are talking about taking some different youth trips this year, so and our children, of course, trying to go to their different camps. So it'd be a wonderful fundraiser, but it also brings back just memories. So y'all participate in that. Hopefully we'll get hundreds of that, so y'all keep that in there. Also, you see the Pregnancy Crisis Center was able to take in $676.56 on the Pregnancy Crisis Center. Thank you so much for giving. It's one thing to say that we're pro-life. It's another thing to participate in that. Also, we'll be having the Children's Church and everything a little bit later. So, look around you. Look around. Why don't you look around? So we all socially distance in here. But you know what they got? They still got space to sit people in. Please invite them. We fluctuate a lot because people have got out of the habit, good habit, of going to the worship service. Invite somebody to church, not just to be for the church, so that we might bring glory and honor unto God. Invite somebody so they hear the gospel. Invite their children. We still have children's church. Leslie's still doing children's church. We have Sunday schools. James, did you have any space in your Sunday school room?
Yeah.
You could probably put another 150 up in there and stuff like that. And Miss Sue, you have any room in your Sunday school room?
Always got room.
So Leslie, y'all have any for the children? All right. So let me invite you and invite those even today. I will have some on the computer today. I've noticed some of these times there'll be close to 200 that are watching the sites. And I was noticing when Shiloh had sang the other day and Layla, that went viral. That was viral. That was like 500 people on there and stuff. You know what? Any way we can get the gospel into a home, we're glad of it. So this morning as we begin services and stuff, is there any prayer requests? Miss Gail, tell them about our friend that, see, he had a...
Hosey
Stewart, right?
Yeah, Hosey Stewart. I went to school with Hosey. He's a really good guy. That's my daughter-in-law's
uncle. So let's remember Hosey Stewart. I want you to remember Bob and Brian McDonald in your prayers. I haven't heard anything from them yet. And Brother Ellis is at, see, it's Mars Hill, right? It's Mars Hill, and the pastor over there has contracted the COVID, but, you know, he was very wise when he first had a symptom, and he didn't go to the church, so it's not all in the church and stuff, but the pastor did get it. So keep his family in your prayers. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am. Yes. So I want you to remember, Brother Eddie's brother, Charles, y'all call him Mac, right? That's Charles Mac. So everybody said, they know him by Mac. Okay, so y'all want y'all to remember Mac. I want you to keep him in your prayers. And also his family, several of them have the COVID, all right? So you know the stresses that are placed on the family. Keep them in your prayers. Anybody else? All right, let's go to Lord in prayer. Brother Al, open us in prayer.
Lord, thank you again for allowing us to be back in your house this morning. Lord, we're thankful for people that come to your house that worshiping you, Lord, and that giving them a great time. Honor you. And I pray, Lord, we'll just get back to normal again in our church. Because of you, that we can be forgiven. And again, I love you, Jesus. I love everything. make the churches for what they are. And we know that the church is a people. And we know that. And thank you again for loving us. And I ask for forgiveness in Christ's name. We pray and pray. Amen.
Amen. All right. Want everyone to join with us in our song service this morning. First song is "He Is So Precious to Me." Precious to you today. All right, our next one is 537. I will sing the wonder story. Next one is a great old song, and I think if you'll stand up with us as we sing this, and I can hear you a little bit better. Victory in Jesus. That song light you far? Victory in Jesus. Let's sing that chorus one more time. I wish you, everybody in here would sing with us, okay, on this chorus. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me. Seated. All right, Miss Herron is going to bring our special music this morning.
Eddie and I. Eddie's going to help me out this morning. He came and practiced with me so we could get it going, and I appreciate him. I appreciate all our pickers and drum players and Miss Burgie. I appreciate all of them. They put a lot of effort into what they do, and I'm thankful for that. This song, the name of it is "That Sounds Like Home to Me." And this just came in my mind this week, and I'm like, okay, Lord, that's the one. It gives us a vision of what heaven, what is waiting for us as a Christian. We'll be there with God, with the saints of God, in His grace and His glory. And it's so easy right now, the way things are going, to just kind of hibernate and say, well, Lord, come on back. But, you know, He's going to come back when He's ready. And until He comes back, we've got a mission. It's more important than ever right now that we live out our calling for Him. And so, but thinking on things like this song kind of gives us a little bit of hope, a little bit of glimmer, a little bit of light at the end of the tunnel. It helps us see the finish line. So my prayer is that you'll be blessed.
Somewhere just across the Jordan River, there's a place of everlasting joy and peace. Where the stream of life is flowing there forever, and a crown of life is waiting there for me. Sounds like home to me, right where I want to be. There'll be no tears to fill our eyes again. The hills will echo with a story as we sing of His grace and glory. Where the saints of God will be, that sounds like home to me. They say there's only joy inside that city, a crystal river flowing by the tree of life. No pain or disappointment's there to hurt us, and Jesus Christ Himself will be the light. And that sounds like home to me, right where I want to be. There'll be no tears to fill our eyes again. The hills will echo with a story as we sing of His grace and glory. Where the saints of God will be, that sounds like home to me. The hills will echo with a story as we sing of His grace and glory. Where the saints of God will be, that sounds like home to me.
Children's Church. Here, giggling going out there. She got her little mermaid and stuff like that. All right. Praise the Lord. If you open your Bibles up to Luke. Luke chapter 15. We're going to read, kind of skip through here a little bit, and different little sections here. So this is one of the stories we know so well in the church. We talk about it all the time. One of the things I was looking at in this particular story is the commonality of the older brother and the younger brother. See, a lot of times when we look at it, we only look at, in this particular verses right here, we look at the younger man. But you know, as different as they were, they had something in common. And I want to look at that in the scripture. If you can stand with me, if you're physically able, would you read these scriptures with me? Would you just stand with me as we honor God's holy word? It says Luke chapter 15, verses 11 through 13, and then we'll skip down to 17. We're going to skip just a little bit. And he said, a man had two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the share of the estate that falls to me. So he divided his wealth between them. And not many days later, the younger son gathered everything together and went on a journey into a distant country. And there he squandered his estate with loose living. Look at verse 17. And when he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired men have more than enough bread, but I am dying with hunger? I will get up, go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me as one of your hired men. Verse 22. But the father said to his slaves, quickly bring out the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet. And bring the fattened calf, kill it, and let us eat and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and has come to life again. He was lost and has been found. And they began to celebrate. Let's look at verse 27. And he said to him, your brother's come, and your father's killed the fattened calf because he has received him back safely and sound. But he became angry and was not willing to go in. And his father came out and began to pleading with him. But he answered, he said to his father, look, for so many years I've been serving you, and I've never neglected a command of yours, and yet you have never given me a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. Yes, use these as our verses today in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you so much, Lord, that, Lord, as we're here today, that you're here with us. Father, there's no better place to be than been right here to hear from you. Our hearts are prepared. We're open to receive your word. Speak to us, we ask, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. You may be seated. So a lot of times when we read this particular story, we look at the younger fellow and we look about how he is left. But these guys have something right here. These guys have something that they're related. Now, they're raised in the same house, and many of y'all have known brothers through the years, and you've seen them in the raised, the same house, and you often wonder, like, whatever happened to them? See, these brothers were totally different. The younger son, he had rebelled against his father. He had left that home place, even had the gall to go up and ask, listen, I want to get what I'm going to be getting as my inheritance, and I want it right now. Man, I am prepared to go and live. I've been suffering around this old goat farm long enough. But the older son had remained faithful and stayed at home and took care of all these different goats and sheep and everything. The younger son, what did he do? He gathered up his stuff and he headed to someplace distant. The older son, he stayed home with the family. The younger son, he just gets wild and crazy and starts going around barroom hopping. The older son, he lived a regulated life doing the same thing over and over. It was closely ordered in his life. He knew what he was going to do day to day. The younger man, he was a playboy. The older guy, he's a plowboy. We see something taking place here. These two sons were totally different, but they had a common theme that was in their heart. And one of the things that we miss is just what's taking place, even though it's right here before our very eyes. as this story starts to develop, both of these come under the judgment of Jesus. Why? You see, it's so obvious to everybody why the younger son is labeled a sinner in the scriptures. But openly he had rebelled. Openly he had rejected. Openly he had wasted his father's money. He lived an immoral life. He was a pure D heathen that everybody could recognize because of what he did. And he ended up a physical and a spiritual wreck from the descriptions that we see in the Bible right here. But why does the older brother come under the condemnation of Jesus Christ? Why? See, the older brother had a bad problem, and he had an attitude problem. It's something that we pass by. Matter of fact, when you read this story, a lot of times you say, well, you know, I can understand his perspective. I can understand why he said what he said and did what he did. And that's where our problem is, because there's a heart problem that's taking place before our very eyes. This younger brother had been away for months and months. Now, can you imagine your brother and no one knew where he was at? They didn't know if he was in the hospital. They didn't know if he got hurt. They didn't know if he was dead. They didn't know if somebody had placed him in a jailhouse. They didn't know where he was at. Maybe he was in a desperate need. Maybe you've experienced it. Maybe you know somebody else experienced it. Maybe you know what it feels like to be in this particular kind of situation. And every single morning, that dad would get up, that father, and he'd go out to that long, dusty road is what I see in my heart, and he's looking for that son to come back home. He's looking for his return. He's looking for a sign somewhere that his lost boy will be back. And every evening, after supper, he'd go to that same spot, and he'd look down that road, and he'd pray for his boy. Lord, if you'll just bring him home. Lord, if you'll just bring my son home. Lord, I pray he comes under conviction and he comes to reality that he needs to come back home. Over and over, that father was going through this same ritual for his little boy. And each day, can you imagine what it feels like? Each day, the desperation was coming in. Each day, that worry. Can you imagine? You've seen it before. There'd be more gray hairs. The eyes would start getting those black rings under it because he's staying up, not sleeping at night. All you see is you start seeing those crow's feet that's developing around the side of the eyes. Dark rings because he wasn't at peace. Then one day, the older brother, he gets back home. He had been working all day in the fields. He had been taking care of the livestock. He had been doing the work. And there was good news. He could see activity because everybody's running around. He could see that everybody was busy as bees. And what do they do? One of them runs up and says, your brother's home. Your brother's home. Your dad's so happy. Your brother's safe. He's not dead. He's returned. But watch how the older brother reacts. How would you react? How would you respond if you're doing supposedly what you're supposed to be doing, and your younger brother who's been running as a heathen comes back home? Did he say, man, I'm so happy. I'm so happy. I've been so concerned. I'm so glad he's come to his senses and he's returned. I've missed him. But look in that verse 28. But he became angry, was not willing to go in, and his father came out and began pleading with him. See, this catches my attention right here. You see, the younger brother was angry because the older brother was angry because the younger brother had came back home. Why? Why won't he go in? Why won't he go greet his brother? See, that's what's wrong. There's a wrong attitude. And we can have that same perspective in our lives too. We can be that same way. Now think. Think of everything that younger brother had missed. He hadn't been there to work the fields. Maybe the hay was coming in. Maybe the sheep had to be tended. I don't know. But there was all these jobs that he had missed, but he came back home. See, a lot of times in our lives, we think about what someone else hasn't done, and we don't think about that lost soul coming back. All we think about is what they haven't done, what they've missed. Now, what would we do as believers if the woman of the well, remember Jesus went to the woman at the well, she had been married, she had been divorced 5 times, and she was living with somebody right then and there, and then all of a sudden she came to the realization she was in the presence of Jesus Christ, and she came home. What would we do if the guy who had been, full of the demons, and Jesus goes to him, and he cast them demons out, and he went back home? How would we greet him? How would we greet the lost one who comes back home? See, a lot of times when we see somebody come in, we say, oh, my goodness, do you not know how many people that woman has been with? She's done been with so-and-so, with so-and-so, or that guy, he has been out on dope for years. I can't believe he's going to come back up in here. Or that other person over there, they never did such and such. I can't believe they've come back home. In other words, our heart is not rejoicing because a lost soul has come back home. See, sometimes our attitudes towards sinners really reveal who we are. See, are we critical or compassionate? It's so easy to be critical. It's so easy, if you don't ever do nothing, to criticize what somebody else does. It's so easy. So you see something taking place. I want you to notice something else in this story. The older brother had not only have a wrong attitude, his whole focus was in the wrong direction. It says in verse 29 right there, it says, but he answered, he said to his father, look, for so many years I've been serving you. Now I want you to watch. And I've never neglected a command of yours. That's good, ain't it? And yet you've never given me a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. I want you to think about it. Over and over in this verse, this guy keeps saying, I, me, my, it just keeps being responded. He looked at his own self-righteousness, his own things that he had done, and he was never concerned about anybody else. Sounds Pharisaic, don't it? It sounds like somebody else. See, in times past, we'd say, that guy's so self-centered. That individual's so selfish. Today we call it narcissism. And it comes all the way from the Greek legend, Narcissus, who fell in love with his own image in that pool of water, and he saw his own image. He said, ooh-wee! Man, I love me some of you. Look at that gray hair. That's a silver fox right there. Man, whoo! I love me you. And what happens is we become so in love in Narcissus. He fell in love with his own image so much that older brother was in love with his self. All he could see and think about was himself. He was busy patting himself on the back. You've done it well. You've been a hard worker. You've been doing all these things. Look at my righteousness. Look at how poor your other son is. He couldn't feel for him. He didn't have any empathy, no sympathy. He didn't have any compassion right there. He was only concerned for self. Can you imagine if that was Jesus Christ? And who are we supposed to be reflecting? Who are we supposed to be showing in our own life is the love of Jesus Christ. And who did Christ go to? When Christ hanged upon the cross of Calvary, there's two other guys hanging there. One on the right, one on the left. One of them says, Lord, remember me today in your paradise. The other guy is over there making fun of Jesus Christ. One of us is one of them. Sometimes we see ourselves as being so righteous and so right when we're not. Sometimes we just can't feel for the older brother who was only concerned with himself. Sometimes we're just like that individual. Sometimes we just can't feel for the younger brother and what they've been through. Sometimes we just can't celebrate when a lost soul gets saved. Sometimes we can't celebrate when somebody else is achieving in the name of Jesus Christ. Sometimes we are just wrong. So you look at this story, and you look at it, and you're going to notice another thing that kind of shows up. It's obvious. And God writes this so that we can see it, so we can look at our own lives. One of the things that you see is that he had the wrong motivation for what he was doing. See, when he complained, he says, I kept all your commandments, and you never even took the time to give me a young kid so I could have my own party. And you're celebrating him. Where's he been at when I needed him? Where's he been at when I wanted something else done? And it reveals the motivation. See, a lot of times we don't understand our own selves because we don't look at ourselves and examine ourselves closely enough. What motivates me to do what I do? See, the older brother, he didn't stay because he loved his father. He didn't stay for that reason. He didn't stay because he knew his dad was getting older and needed help and stuff like that. He didn't obey the commands because he wanted to please his father or because he loved the father. He stayed for what he could get out of it. One of these days, this old dude's going to croak, and I'm going to inherit it anyway. And then all of a sudden, younger brother shows up. Now I'm going to have to do something else. You see? You see what's taking place right here? You know, have you ever heard that statement? If you were put on trial for being Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you? I've heard that 10,000 times in my life. I've heard it said over and over. I said it myself. But what would take place if we took this a little bit further? What would take place if we examined it a little bit closer? What if they had to establish a motive for why I'm doing what I'm doing? Am I doing it for salary? Am I doing it for vacation? Am I doing it for the luxuries of being a pastor? Why do you do what you do? Do you stay in it because of a little money? Do you stay in it because of recognition? Do you stay in it because of power? Or do you do it so that lives might be touched with the gospel message? And it always shows up in our speech. It always shows up in our actions. Why do you go to church? Why do you read the Bible? Why do you pray? Why do you tithe? What is your motivation behind what you're doing? Is it just because I just want to go to heaven and this is way my paying my way through there or something like that, or this is my way of being recognized? There's always something motivates you. You've got to examine yourself. Why do you do what you do? Are you pushed for the desire for attention? Are you pushed out of fear because of fear of going to hell? Are you pushed by outside pressures that you never thought about before and all of a sudden it becomes right here in your face? Or do you do it for the love of Jesus Christ? So think, you can go to big churches or little churches. And you know, every church has somewhat similarities of what they do. And there's always somebody doing something. But can you imagine going to a little church and there's five people and you have a position in the church? What would you do if there was only five here? What would you do if there was only two here? What would you do? Why are you doing what you do? In the verse 30, this is what it says. But when this son of yours came. That sounds familiar to me. Remember when Adam and Eve were in the garden? He says, you know that woman you gave me? But when this son of yours came, who has devoured your wealth with prostitutes, you killed the fattened calf for him. You let that lowly sinner in here, Lord. You see something? You see, the older brother had a wrong understanding that was taking place in his heart. He was speaking of the son who had came home, and he called him that son of yours. He's missing, because that son of his was who? It was the older brother's brother. His brother, the only brother they talk about in the scriptures right here. He didn't say, my brother. He said, your son. And see, the father, he caught that comment, and you see in verse 32, you see something take place. But we had to celebrate and rejoice, for this brother of yours, got it? So the dad caught it. The father caught it. He said, but that brother of yours was dead and has begun to live and was lost and has been found. It's so subtle, but it's the truth. You see, he's trying to correct the other brother's mentality. This brother of yours is beginning to recognize that there is a brotherhood. This is your family. This is yours right here. But you know what the other brother was missing? He didn't understand being a brother. Can you have that problem too? Can I have that problem too? It's so easy to just have someone who we say is a brother, but do we treat them truly as a brother? There's people all around us. One of the things that I've always held special, and I'm going to tell you, as you go up north, you miss it. That's why it's so important to teach our children to call somebody brother, sister. You know why? Because in the family of God, we're the children of God, and thus that makes us brothers and sisters. When I went up north, they didn't do that. They don't say Mr. and Miss. They don't say brother and sis. They were missing it. They would just say, like Blaine. They don't call you pastor. And what happens is you miss the understanding of what it's supposed to be teaching us. When we come in church and we talk about individuals and we've lost that tradition of saying brother and sister so-and-so. Now think about it in your own conversation. Think about it when you're talking to somebody. And what that was supposed to do was bring us together recognizing who we are as the children of God. That Jesus Christ shed his blood upon Calvary for all of us. We're blood kin bought by the Master himself, who's transformed us and made us where I love them as my brother or my sister. See, if we really love each other, we won't reject each other. We'll miss each other. We'll desire, kind of like every Sunday, being in that family reunion, to gather together in the place of worship, to worship our Father who's in heaven. So ultimately, the whole problem when you see these scripture is the older brother had the wrong relationship with the father himself. So many times we're looking at the younger guy, but we're missing it right here. The other brother, he was just devoted to the father's law. You get up every day and you do these certain things. But he didn't have any sympathy for the heart of the father. What about us? See, it's one thing to go and just do these certain rituals, these certain things right here. But do we do it for the love of Jesus Christ? See, he stayed in the Father's house, but he didn't stay in it because it was the home. You know, in Jesus' parable right here, this older brother, the whole reminder is the Christian faith is not based upon the rules and it's not based upon the rituals. It's based upon the relationships. So when I'm in there, I obey the Ten Commandments, not out of fear. It's because I love the Father. I love him and I want to obey him. So when that relationship's right, your love of the Father, you understand so much more. You see things differently. You recognize your brothers and your sisters. And I'm going to tell you, when it's your brother and sister, how often will you criticize what they've done or what they haven't done? How many times will you crucify, because criticizing, when you look in the scriptures, is described as a crucifixion. So our focus has to be right. So let me ask you, so as I get older, unfortunately, I have to wear these glasses, and these are bifocals. So at the bottom, it's supposed to make it look closer when I'm reading, and then these on top is supposed to adjust my eyesight because my sight has an imperfection in it. And sometimes you can have a spiritual imperfection. And what Christ does, if we allow him, what he does is he comes and he corrects the way we see things. He corrects our concern about other people and how we affect them. And we lose that self-centeredness that so easily besets us. See, our attitude is right when we go and we rejoice with those who return. But sometimes, if we're not careful, we rejoice more at their suffering. Oh, not me, you say. How many times have you seen somebody come into church and say, I can't believe they're at church. I can't believe that individual's here. Not after what they've done. They need to go somewhere else. Just like the father welcomed back the prodigal son right here. The father, he went out to that older brother, and what did he do? He uplifted him. He uplifted him and encouraged him to what? Come home. See, he didn't just call out to the younger one. He's calling out to the older one. And God is showing this to us for a reason. So you can be right here in this facility, in this church service, and still not be home. Still not be where you should be. Now, whether we can be the prodigal son or whether we can be the older brother right here, you can be lost at home. You see, you can come to your father's house, and what happens is he's going to welcome you. No matter what you've done, no matter where you've been, if you turn away from that sin. Here's the thing. So the older son was living there the whole time, obeying these legal rules, yet his heart was never transformed. We can be coming here all the time, and our heart never be transformed by the blood of Jesus, and our vision is blurred. We're still doing things incorrectly. Because we're not doing it for the love of the Father. I was watching somebody witness this week. I was at somebody's house, and we were talking about witnessing, and he was describing to me witnessing. And he actually goes to college campuses. Can you imagine? He goes to college campus, and he goes to the free speech court. Every college campus is required to have a free speech area. Every single one of them, even though they persecute us when Christians go to it. And he started talking about, he says, you know the worst problem I have when I go to free speech court in all these college campuses all across this country, and he goes in Mississippi, he goes in Texas, he goes in Florida, he goes all over, has a wonderful witness and testimony. He says, the ones who give me the most problem are the ones who proclaim themselves born again. They always ridicule me and say that I should not be sharing my Jesus outside of the church. Funny, isn't it? Would you think of that? Why? It's because their vision is blurred. Their heart is not correct. And when they come home, sometimes when we're out here, I've seen people shocked when somebody gets saved. I've seen people amazed. I've seen multiple deacons. I even seen a preacher get saved. I've seen all sorts of things. They said, well, they were always good. But when the Holy Spirit had convicted them, they realized they had never gave their heart to Jesus Christ. Are your eyes open? If you acknowledge the Father, you could come home. Think of how you handle things, how you treat people, how you look at things. It's just like Brother Raymond sings all the time. Come home, come home, ye who are weary. Come home. Jesus is calling. Jesus is calling. If you really love the Father, do you hear the voice? If you could bow your heads just a moment. Brother Raymond's coming down. He's going to do an altar call soon. And as all, everybody comes, it's so important that we examine ourselves. It's so important that we keep our relationship so close to Christ. You know, I was talking to somebody the other day. I said, you know, one of the biggest problems is whether we're lukewarm or on fire. You ever study that? Am I just trying to be good enough? You see, when you fall in love with Jesus Christ, you lose the satisfaction that the world is giving you. When you fall in love with the Father who is in heaven and you understand all the plan that he has and how it has taken place, and you're saying, my goodness, he loved me this much from the very beginning, he had a plan for my salvation. You don't worry about what everything else says, what everybody else is doing. You worry about your relationship with the Father. How do you talk to your dad? Have you been playing? He's calling. Can you hear him? He's calling. And all we got to do is love the Father. He says, I'll welcome you home. As the Holy Spirit speaks to us today, these altars are open. Altars are what we have down front. We kneel. We pray. Sometimes we're coming down here for salvation. Sometimes we're coming down here just to pray over needs or praying for the healing of the land, praying for presidents and Congress and all those teachers, all just different things that the Holy Spirit's laid upon our heart. That's what we call and mean by altars, when we get down and just pray. They're open today. And as the Spirit leads, won't you come today?
Speak to my heart, Lord Jesus. Speak that my soul may hear. Speak to my heart, Lord Jesus. Come every doubt and fear. Speak to my
thank you so much that we could gather here today, Lord, as just a family of Christ, to hear the word, Lord, and just to celebrate you. I thank you so much for all these Sunday school teachers, all these musicians, all those in the sound booth, all those who are working with the children's church. For Father, they do it unto glorify you, Father, that we might spread the good news of Jesus Christ. Lord, know our heart, for Father, we love you. All our actions and deeds, we pray, Father, will reflect you, that others might see Jesus Christ in us. Lord, we ask that you place a hedge of protection about each one here, Father, that we remain healthy, Father, that we remain strong, and that, Lord, we remain knowing that the fields are white into harvest. So, Lord, go with us today in peace, we pray in Jesus' name.